Hello everybody, welcome here to Performance on Wheels. Today we're starting up our new three-part series on our recently purchased 2011 Land Rover Range Rover Supercharged.
Guys, we're watching the first part of that series and we are talking specifically about a buyer's guide if you're in the market for a used Range Rover.
The second part of the series is going to be the cost of ownership followed by a full-out review. Let's get right into it. A brief history.
This is the L322, which is the third generation of the Range Rover. Range Rover is a model underneath Land Rover. We are looking at the full-size Range Rover, not the Range Rover Sport. You can tell that by this on the exterior. The Range Rover Sport has more of a sideways or a horizontal vent, where the full-size has that vertical vent. They look very similar on the outside is why I bring that up. The interiors are different as well. They are different vehicles. The Range Rover L322 was introduced in 2004-ish and went all the way till the 2012 model year. We're looking at 2010, 11, and 12, all very similar vehicles.
Moving forward with the exterior. The Land Rover Range Rover Supercharged is crafted of mostly aluminum, but that doesn't really make much sense considering the fact that it is about a 6,000 pound SUV. Absolutely massive. The thing's a tank, it really is. That is because not everything is aluminum. So that means that things can rust, which is especially common here in Minnesota with the amount of salt that they use on our roads. So I'm gonna go ahead and show you the parts of the vehicle that are aluminum and steel and where to watch out for that rust. This fender right here is aluminum. This is not going to rust. The doors, those are aluminum as well. This roof here is steel, and this is steel as well. So if you open up your doors, that means it's very possible that it is going to have some rust on the inner parts of the doors. So be sure to watch out for that. Let's move around to the back to see where you can find some rust. So the top piece of the trunk is aluminum. So we can go ahead and open that up. The trunk, however, or the tailgate, I should say, is not. This is steel, so you're gonna be seeing rust down in these corners. Be sure to watch out for that. And when we open that up, a very common spot for rust is right in these areas, these tight little crevices here. Also be sure that this opens and closes just fine. There can get some corrosion in these, so that those are where you wanna look out for rust. Moving into the engine bay.
One thing that is great about the AJ133, the 5-liter supercharged, is they do an awesome job of getting up to temp very quickly, and they hold on to the temperature for quite some time.
Which is very great here in Minnesota, so that way when you're stranded and stuck out in the middle of nowhere on your midnight adventures, rather than figuring out how to start a fire, you can just pop the hood and warm up. Before we get into some of the issues you're going to find with the engine, I would like to say we are going to go over them, but we're not going to talk about the cost of those. That will be under the cost of ownership video. So if you have any interest in how much some of the things we are going to be talking about cost, be sure to check out the next video in the series.
Here we go, AJ series 5-liter supercharged V8, over 500 horsepower. We're looking at the cream of the crop. You can also get that same 2010 to 2012. You can even get a current day Range Rover with the same motor. However, there's a naturally aspirated version as well. This is where there's some points of contention, guys. Looking at it, listening to this engine run, not only when it's cold, make sure you can listen to one on a cold start and make sure you can listen to one when it's up to operating temperature as well. The biggest thing you got to be mindful of is that timing chain. The timing chain, the tensioners and the guides, that is the fault of this engine. There's a very high probability that it will need to be addressed at some point in time. What you're listening for is something that sounds like a rattle. So we're not talking about ticking, we're not talking about knocking. It's more of a rattle. Think of a chain against a bunch of metal. So just listening to the engine, there is some ticking that is common on these motors. That can be either your fuel injectors or even the fuel pump is known to make some ticking noises. So just make sure you're paying attention to the few things. There's also kind of a known issue with ticking up front, again, not a rattle, with the fan and the fan clutch needing to be replaced. You get this steady tick, tick, tick. So just things to be mindful. Listening to the motor is important. Something else you need to be mindful of is the cooling system in the Range Rover. The water pump is known to leak. There's a lot of plastic parts in that cooling system that are known to leak. The cooling reservoir has been known to fail. But guys, these aren't massive repairs when I'm talking about the cooling system. We'll get into that in our two-part series. On the Supercharged model, there's a known fault on the stout of the supercharger itself. Again, that's gonna be like a clicking noise. I say all that, guys, with a grain of salt. This engine is known to be pretty darn reliable. So yes, there are some faults with it. There are some things to be mindful of. Some of those can be very costly. Make sure you check out that two-part series of the video. But these engines, guys, there's tons of these on the road with 120, 160, 200,000. I even drove the version before this, the 4.2, that had 210,000 miles on it, and it wasn't skipping a beat. So again, throughout the third generation Range Rover, there's a lot of different motors. We started off with the BMW motor. We went to the Jaguar and Ford ownership with the 4.2. And then we went to more of a specific Jaguar motor, the 5-liter. And then overseas, you guys are fortunate to have a bunch of those diesel motors that have a pretty good reputation under the Ford ownership. I interviewed the Land Rover specialty shop in our area, as well as the shop foreman at the Range Rover dealership. And I was like, what do I need to be mindful of? Where my head gasket's gonna go? What? You know, I was just interviewing, trying to get a feel of what they see on a regular basis. They both agreed that the timing chain can be a problem. That's a known fault. Make sure you're budgeting for that and you're aware of it. They also said regular oil changes are huge on this. That's a huge preventer for that timing chain, as well as just, that's the Range Rover in general. They like maintenance. There's no denying they like maintenance. It's a fact. From the factory, they say 16,000 mile oil change. Nah, that's not what you want to do. Again, part two series, we're going to dive deeper into that. So under the hood, if those few things are addressed, or if you are prepared for those repairs, you really have a pretty rock solid drivetrain with over 500 horsepower. We get behind that motor and we have a 6-speed ZF transmission. Pretty bulletproof. There's not a lot. Everything has a fail point, but there's not too much need to worry about there. Change the fluid when it needs to be changed, and it's a pretty darn good transmission.
Onto the suspension system. I'm going to start raising this vehicle as I talk about the air suspension. It is currently down as low as it'll go. I'm going to raise it to the maximum as I talk, so just be aware of that. You can watch it go up as I'm speaking. The air compressor is in the trunk. The air tank is under the car by the passenger. And there is leveling sensors at all four corners, as well as air shocks. All of those components could fail. The most common would be the compressor or the shocks. The shocks and the compressor are not cheap, and they're a very common fail point. We will talk about the price of those when we get into the maintenance cost video, but I should just let you know one of the ways to check to see if that works. Bring the car all the way up, and see, once the vehicle says it's reached its maximum height, see if you can hear the compressor continue to run. The compressor makes a small running noise. You can hear it. And if it still runs after the vehicle says it's at its maximum height, it's very possible that you have a leak in one of the bags. Moving on to the electronics.
In the Range Rover, it's said that there's up to 25 different computers. That's pretty insane. That's a lot of different computers that have to talk to each other. So if you're in the market and you're shopping, I strongly suggest that you get in and you make sure everything works. There's a 3-zone climate control. There's all these different features on the steering wheel. Go through and make sure everything works and that there's not any flaws. A small flaw can turn into a big electrical gremlin, so just make sure you're mindful of that.
End conclusion.
You do a Google search of Range Rover, the first thing that comes up after that as it autofills is the reliability. So there's no denying it's on a lot of people's minds, and there's no hidden secret. But I think there's more to it than just going than dismissing them, because you're missing something that's truly brilliant. You just need to be informed and prepared going into Range Rover ownership. It's definitely not for everyone. There's no denying there are higher costs associated with it. This is one vehicle I would strongly, strongly recommend that you get up on a lift, that you have a professional look at. Range Rovers are known to leak. Make sure that you don't have a bunch of seeping and oozing pipes and hoses and gaskets and everything else. Also, the importance of having maintenance history is extremely important on a vehicle like this.
Yes, it is. So be sure to check out our other two videos coming up in the series and let us know what Range Rover that you are looking at in the comments down below. Thank you guys so much for watching today's video. Be sure to smash that like button and check out some of our other videos floating around in the atmosphere right now. I hope you have a great day.